chapter 5 and verse 2. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That word poor, you look that word poor up, you'll find out it means humble. So in other words, if you've got the humility of God inside you, you're blessed. God really blesses people that are humble. Now, out in the world, they consider a humble person or a meek person somebody that's a coward. But if you're a humble person, you're not a coward. Because anytime you want to, you can stand up and tell them about the things of God. Even though you're humble, you can declare the counsel of God to the world. You can declare what you believe in the Word of God to the world. Look at this man that just got kicked out of his office on Facebook, the Duck Dynasty man that was the leader of that. Just because he stood up for his godly values, they fired him. That's the way the world looks at it. But God said, if we're a humble person, we're blessed. We're blessed of God. And God blesses you all through your life through your humbleness. Because who was the most humble person on the earth with the exception of Moses? None other than Jesus Christ. You never see Jesus in his ministry ever taking vengeance on anybody that opposed him, with one exception. When the money changers were in the temple. So God can get angry. If you've ever read the history on that, what they were doing, see the way God set things up in that time when people had sinned or done something wrong, they had to bring their offering to the temple right down Main Street so everybody could see what the situation was. What they were doing, they could come through the back alley into the temple and buy an offering, whether it be a goat, a sheep, a turtle dove, or whatever it was, and not. See, God desires open confession. If we've transgressed the law of God or done something that has displeased God, God wants to hear it personally from you and I. Don't come hiding to God trying to get victory over it because it won't work. We've got to come right to the altar of a repentance and start repenting of that situation or that condition that we have been part of and ask God for forgiveness and be honest and upright with God. That's what he requires. So what did Jesus do? He got angry. And he went over there and overturned the tables. Took the tables and just turned them all upside down. And then got a whip and drove them out of the temple. So don't think that God can't get angry over things, because he will. When they continue, people continue to push God away, continue to make up their mind not to hear the word of God and not to pay attention to God's word or not to adhere to God's word. After a while, God gets tired of it and he says, enough is enough. I'm going to take care of the situation. So blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And this is not necessarily, it goes along with this, but this is not necessarily mourning about a lost loved one. That goes along with it, because I'm going to tell you something. If you lose a lost loved one, I can try to comfort you. Other people can try to comfort you. But you know what? There's nobody in a situation like that that can really comfort you except the Lord Jesus Christ. He said that he would be giving us peace in situations like that. And even Peter talks about the peace that passeth understanding. How can you lose a family member and be all tore up over it, and all of a sudden, peace comes over your soul? That comes from God. I can't give you my peace. You can't give me your peace, but God can give you and me both His peace. And I'll tell you, His peace is real. Trust me, because when my dad dies, I spent my whole life under my dad's ministry. I've learned my faith from my dad. I learned a lot of things from my dad. But when he passed away, it did a number on me. I'm going to tell you, I really had to go before God and seek the Lord to find peace in that situation when my dad passed away. Because, see, the responsibility of the church, at that time I was the assistant pastor, this responsibility of the church fell on me. Believe you me, that's a heavy responsibility. And though things happened in my home life that denied me the opportunity of stepping into that position, that's where I'm at now. But I'll tell you, nobody can bring peace like God can bring peace. So he says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. God hates pride. God, let me say that again. Don't ever let pride come into your heart. Don't ever think that you're above somebody else in the church. Don't ever think because you have a position in church that you've got the right to have pride. But I'm going to tell you, don't ever let that spirit enter your heart, because if you do, you're going to get in trouble with the Lord. Look what happened to Satan. In the 12th chapter of the book of Isaiah, God spoke to Satan and said this, you, now notice what God is saying here. You have said in your heart, he didn't say it verbally, he thought it first. It came to his mind, then it got to his heart, and he said, I will ascend to the heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. And then all of a sudden, God started speaking to him, telling him what was going to happen to him. Pride. Bible says that pride cometh before a fall, and a haughty spirit before destruction. So stay meek, saints. Stay humble. That's what God desires. That's what appeases the heart of God. Staying humble. You don't have to let people walk all over you because you're a meek person, because you're a humble person. If they're trying to degrade you or trying to put you down, just laugh in their face. I found out that works. I've had people say derogatory things about me, even lie about me, and I just start laughing. And I've even told people that were trying to put me down and browbeat me, and I'd tell them like this. I'd tell them, look, that's your opinion. And just because you're spouting your opinion does not make anything right. I know who I am. I know what I am, and you can talk all day long about me and try to put me down, but it's nothing more than your opinion. You're entitled to your opinion, but it don't make you right. You know what they do? They shut their mouth. Every time they shut their mouth. So you don't have to let people walk all over you because you're a humble person, because you're a meek person. You can stand up for your godly rights. You can stand up for the Word of God And what you believe in the Word of God, what the Word of God tells us, you can stand up anytime. And sometimes you just have to get vehement against people that are trying to bring falsehood to you. Tell them about the Word of God. What does the Word of God say about this situation? Well, I know I had an altercation with my wife's sister one time about the oneness of God and baptism in Jesus' name. Oh, my, she got hot. I took her to the 24th chapter of the book. She was talking about baptism and Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and I took her to the 24th chapter of the book of Luke, where Jesus told his disciples, he said, now hear what he said, that repentance and remission of sin should be preached where? In Jerusalem, in my name. And I said, what does that do with Matthew 28:19? I said, it virtually throws it out. Boy, she got mad. Her face got as red as your brother back there, your red shirt. Her face got that red. And my wife came in real quick. We were up in the kitchen, and she come through the front room, and she went like this. Slow down, slow down. She's going to have a heart attack. Well, what she told me, she said, Jesus didn't say those words. She said, John said Jesus said those words. Well, what's the difference? Jesus still said it. Let me tell you something. Matthew 28:19 is not a bad thing to live by, but it's not a good thing to die by. Matthew 28:19 will never save anybody. The only thing that's going to save anybody is repentance, baptism in the name of Jesus, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Those are titles. You baptize them in titles, they're going to go down there a wet center and come up a dry center and come up a wet center. See, it's the name of Jesus professed over the water that removes the sin. What is it? The name of Jesus is the cleansing agent. The blood is in the name. The blood is what cleanses us from our sins. And without baptism in the name of Jesus, you've never had your sins removed. You've never had your sins covered. Except through the name of Jesus. Only way. Bible tells us in the book of Acts, no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. You know what? I ain't even going to make it through the rest of this. The time has gotten by. I'll tell you, there is a lot in the Word of God. I'm going to turn it back to Brother Price.